Before watching this video, I would suggest you to watch bioenergetics video. Have you ever wondered how the food you eat provides you energy? The food we eat is first digested, okay? That is the first part, okay? Then macromolecules are produced from the food, okay? And electrons are extracted from these macromolecules, okay? So this is the first phase, okay? First phase of metabolism is digestion and absorptions. This will be dealt in your physiology videos, so we won't be discussing digestion and absorption in our metabolism class, okay? This extraction of electrons from the macromolecules is your intermediate metabolism, okay? Whenever you say metabolism, that usually refers to intermediate metabolism, okay? Then TCA cycle. TCA cycle is the final common oxidative pathway. It extracts the maximum number of electrons, okay? Certain textbook, they consider TCA cycle also as intermediate metabolism. Certain textbook, they consider TCA cycle as a third phase, okay? Anyway, there is extraction of electrons. Then the final stage is your cellular respiration or internal respiration, okay? Internal respiration. Why this is known as respiration? See here, there is utilization of oxygen in the electron transport chain. So the final stage is all the electrons which are harvested from the macromolecules are passed in the electron transport chain to produce ATP. In this process, oxygen is converted to water. That is why this final stage is known as internal respiration. Clear? So here we will see the concepts of this oxidation, because I have told you that how we get ATP from the food, it is by extracting electrons. Loss of electrons is oxidation, so it is very important to see how this oxidation process happens, okay? This is to teach you what is oxidation and reduction. Loss of electrons is oxidation, gain of electrons is reduction. There is no pure oxidative reaction, there is no pure reduction reaction, okay? If something is oxidized, something will be reduced. Is it clear? That is why we call this as redox reactions, okay? And the enzymes which catalyze these reactions are known as oxidoreductases, okay? That is your EC1, enzyme class 1. So they are oxidoreductases, clear? And here you will see the coupling, okay? Exergonic reaction is coupled with endergonic reaction, okay? So this is to signify that. Now let's see the four classes of oxidoreductases. The mnemonic is HOOD, H-O-O-D, hydroperoxidases, oxidases, oxygenases and dehydrogenases. First, we will see what are hydroperoxidases, then I will differentiate these three in a table so that you can easily understand. Hydroperoxidases, they use H2O2 as a substrate. Hydroperoxidases, they don't produce H2O2, okay? They use H2O2 as a substrate and they destroy this H2O2. For example, catalase and your glutathione peroxidase, okay? So these are hydroperoxidases. But if you see xanthine oxidase will produce H2O2, okay? It is not a hydroperoxidase. Okay, now let us differentiate the other three classes: oxidase, oxygenase and dehydrogenase. First, let's begin with dehydrogenation. Dehydrogenation is the process of removal of hydrogen. So, dehydrogenases are the enzymes involved in this. When there is removal of hydrogen, there should be someone to accept that. Okay. So, these are those acceptors, NAD plus, FAD and NADP plus. These are the coenzymes in your enzymatic reactions. Okay. Here, it's given hydrogen. That does not mean that only hydrogen is accepted. Actually, these coenzymes, they accept what is known as reducing equivalents. So, in your biochemistry textbooks, in so many places they use the term reducing equivalents, but they have not given what exactly is a reducing equivalent. A reducing equivalent is either of these three. It can be a lone electron, okay. It can be a hydride ion, that is H minus, or it can be a hydrogen, okay, that is proton plus electron. Either of these three is known as reducing equivalents, okay, and these reducing equivalents are accepted by these coenzymes NAD plus, FAD, NADP plus. So, these dehydrogenases cannot use oxygen as the hydrogen acceptor. They can use only these three. Example of a dehydrogenase is succinate dehydrogenase. Okay. Let us see about oxygenases. As the name suggests, they incorporate one or two oxygen atoms into the substrate. Okay. If they incorporate one atom of oxygen, they are monooxygenase. If they incorporate two atoms of oxygenase, they are dioxygenase. Example is phenylalanine hydroxylase, which is a monooxygenase. We will discuss mono and dioxygenase in subsequent slides. And the third is oxidases. Here, oxidation is catalyzed without incorporation of oxygen. So, oxygenation and oxidation are different. Hemoglobin, there is oxygenation. Okay, in hemoglobin there is oxygenation. If hemoglobin is oxidized, it will become methemoglobin. Okay, here oxidation is what? Without incorporating oxygen. Okay, so here they remove hydrogen from the substrate and they use oxygen as the acceptor. That is the difference between dehydrogenase and oxidase. Okay. Both can remove hydrogen, okay, but here oxygen is used as the acceptor. For example, cytochrome oxidase, that is the enzyme which can produce water in the body by combining your hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, cytochrome oxidase. Xanthine oxidase, xanthine oxidase produces hydrogen peroxide. I told you, right? Xanthine oxidase produces hydrogen peroxide. Now we have to see why FADH2 is written as FADH2 and NADH is written as NADH and H+. This is very important for understanding this. See the structure of FADH2. See, this is your FAD, oxidized flavin. This contains an isoalloxazine ring. Isoalloxazine ring. Okay. So, if you see, two hydrogen atoms are incorporated in this ring, okay. So, two hydrogen atoms, that means it is H2, okay. So, that is why FAD and FADH2 are written in that way, okay. But if you see the NAD, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, okay, you will see that, see, there is already a plus, there is already a plus, okay. So, we actually add a hydride. So, the reducing equivalent added to the NAD plus is hydride, okay, NAD plus plus H minus, okay, that's what here. See, H plus and 2 electron minus, that is your H minus and a proton, okay. So, in this process, a proton is released into the surroundings, okay. So, In NAD plus, hydride ion is added and a proton is released. For example, see this reaction. Pyruvate, lactate. Okay. So, what is happening? Lactate can be oxidized to pyruvate. Okay. So, in this process, a H plus is released. That is very, very important. Okay. NADH and NADPH are different. That you should understand. See the difference. The difference is a phosphate. Our enzymes are so specific. Okay. Certain enzymes uses NADP plus as a coenzyme. Certain enzymes use NAD plus as coenzymes. Okay. They are specific. There is only one enzyme which can use either of these. Do you remember which enzyme can use both? That is your glutamate dehydrogenase. Okay. It can use either of these. Okay. Now, you should remember these reactions in which FADH2 is produced. I won't suggest you to memorize those reactions in which NADH is produced. There are so many reactions, but there are only three reactions in which FADH2 is released. So, it is very easy to remember. Succinate dehydrogenase, you know it is a TCA cycle enzyme and it is also a electron transport chain component complex 2. Then mitochondrial glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. Okay. And your fatty acyl CoA dehydrogenase of beta oxidation. Okay. All these reactions, they are happening where? They are happening in the mitochondrial matrix. You can remember like this also. They are all happening in the mitochondrium matrix. Some of the reaction, for example, see here, it is not happening in the matrix, but it is happening in the mitochondrium. Okay, mitochondrial side, glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. It is happening in the mitochondrial side. Okay. Now, I would suggest you to remember these three reactions also. These are the only three reactions where NADPH is produced. You know, HMP shunt is the major source of NADPH. In HMP shunt, two enzymes can produce NADPH. Those are glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase, that is G6PD, and your 6-phosphogluconolactone dehydrogenase. Other enzymes, you may not be aware, but I want you to understand this enzyme. This is malic enzyme. Don't confuse this enzyme with malate dehydrogenase. Okay, it's a different enzyme. Malic enzyme converts malate to pyruvate. It is an oxidative decarboxylation reaction. Clear? So, in this, NADPH is produced and there is an isocitrate dehydrogenase in cytoplasm also. Okay, isocitrate dehydrogenase is a TCA cycle enzyme. You know it is present in the mitochondrial matrix. There is another isoenzyme present in the cytosol also. It will produce NADPH. Okay. What is the role of NADPH? I told you that NADH and FADH2, they will give their electron in the electron transport chain to produce ATP. Okay. Or they will give their electron in some other reactions. Okay. The main purpose is for electron transport chain only. Okay. But NADPH cannot give its electron to electron transport chain. Okay. The purpose of reducing power here is in the reductive biosynthetic reaction. Reductive biosynthetic reactions like fatty acid synthesis, cholesterol synthesis, okay, introducing double bonds in the fatty acids to create unsaturated fatty acids. Okay. So, this is the role of NADPH. And there is an enzyme NADPH oxidase. There NADPH is the source of electrons for the production of free radicals. Okay. Superoxide. Superoxide radical. Okay. So, NADPH oxidase enzyme uses NADPH in a different way, okay, to produce free radical. So, but the major role is reductive biosynthetic reaction. NADPH is not used in electron transport chain. The mnemonic is, you can use your own mnemonic, but if you want, you can use this mnemonic: government, medical, colleges, dehydrated. So that you can remember this isocitrate dehydrogenase. C is for iso, dehydrated is for isocitrate dehydrogenase. Now, it's time to differentiate two types of oxygenases, mono, di. Mono, this means one oxygen is incorporated into the substrate. Di means two oxygens are incorporated. So, in oxygen, there are two oxygen atoms, right? If you incorporate one oxygen atom into the substrate, what will do with the other oxygen? These enzymes, they incorporate the other oxygen to hydrogen to produce water, okay? So, that is why these monooxygenases are also known as mixed function oxidases. What? Mixed function. Because they incorporate one oxygen atom into the substrate and the other oxygen atom into the hydrogen to produce water. You know cytochrome P450. We have elaborately discussed this in our xenobiotic video. Okay, it is a best example for your mixed function oxidase. Okay, and most of your hydroxylases are monooxygenases. See here, this is phenylalanine hydroxylase. So you may think that hydroxyl group is added in the phenylalanine to produce tyrosine. It's wrong. Actually, one oxygen atom is added because there is already hydrogen, right? C6H6. What we are doing? C6H5OH. See this. The hydrogen was already there. We are actually incorporating one hydrogen atom. So, most of the hydroxylases are monooxygenases except lysine and proline hydroxylases, which are actually dioxygenases. This is not that much important for your exam purpose. Just for understanding, I am telling you, lysine and proline hydroxylases are dioxygenases. Now, let us see the other dioxygenases. This is very, very important to remember. I have already discussed dioxygenases in aromatic amino acid metabolism. I told you that the cleavage of the ring of aromatic amino acids require dioxygenases. I told you, right? So, tryptophan pyrrolase, it is an aromatic amino acid. Homogentisic acid oxidase, again aromatic amino acid. Okay. Catechol dioxygenases, aromatic amino acids. Then other dioxygenases are like cysteine dioxygenase and lipoxygenases. So, these are the dioxygenases. They incorporate both the atoms of oxygen into substrate. Clear? See the dioxygenase here. Your lysyl hydroxylase is a dioxygenase. Okay. It is not producing water. It incorporates oxygen into substrates, okay, in one substrate or two substrates, okay. See, you know beta carotene is a provitamin A, okay, provitamin A. By splitting beta carotene, we can theoretically produce two molecules of active retinal. Again, there is a beta carotene dioxygenase. This dioxygenases, they are usually used for splitting the molecules. See here, tryptophan pyrrolase. So, this is an indole ring, right? Tryptophan contains indole ring. What is an indole? I discussed this in amino acid chemistry class. Remember, what is indole? Indole is 2,3-benzpyrrole. Okay. So, we are actually cleaving the pyrrole ring. That is why it is a tryptophan pyrrolase or tryptophan dioxygenase. Clear? See, there is cleavage of the aromatic ring. Now, it's time to understand this concept, redox potential. Redox potential is very simply, if you want to say, it is the electronegativity. Okay. It is the tendency of a molecule to accept or give electron. Okay. We always compare redox potential with the hydrogen electrode. Okay. We say that the standard hydrogen electrode has a redox potential of 0. Okay. Compared with that, we measure the redox potential. If a molecule has a tendency to give electron, the symbol is negative. Okay, the symbol is negative. See here, NADH has a tendency to give electron. Okay, but oxygen has a tendency to accept electron. Okay, that is why the symbol is plus. When the symbol is minus, it means it is going to donate electron. Okay, more tendency to donate electron. When the symbol is plus, there is more tendency to accept electron. Okay, you know that the final acceptor of electrons in the human body is oxygen. Clear? In pyruvate dehydrogenase reaction, which is the final acceptor of electrons? NAD plus. Okay, see here. So NAD plus can accept reducing equivalents from the pyruvate. Okay, but ultimately it has to give electron through the electron transport chain. You can see the components of electron transport chain. See here. See the components of electron transport chain. See, not this. See the cytochrome, ubiquinone, cytochrome C. These are all the components of electron transport chain. So the electrons can be actually go through this pathway. Okay, these are the redox potential values of certain molecules. See here, NADH, NAD plus pair has a redox potential of minus 0.32. That means it has more tendency to give electron. But if you see the oxygen water redox couple, they are also known as redox couple. Okay, this pair is known as redox couple. It has a value of plus 0.82. That means it has the tendency to accept electron. You know that the final acceptor of electrons in the electron transport chain is oxygen. Okay, so oxygen has more electronegativity or more affinity to electrons. Clear? NAD plus or this NADH, this couple, it tends to give electron. Okay, so you know NADH gives electron in the electron transport chain. See here, these are all the components of electron transport chain only, right? So NADH is going to give electrons here, and these electrons, they are run through the electron transport chain, and ultimately they are given to the oxygen to produce water. You are not seeing NADPH here. See, in this table there is no NADPH because NADPH cannot give its electron to electron transport chain, but it has to give it electron, right? See, NADPH, when it gives two electron, it will become NADP plus. Okay, so these two electrons are given to molecules. For example, if it is given to a fatty acid, there will be a double bond formation. Okay, there will be a double bond formation. There will be already one bond in the fatty acid. Okay, two electrons means one bond, one single bond means two electrons. Okay, so there is a creation of double bond. Like this, NADPH is involved in fatty acid synthesis and cholesterol biosynthesis and all. Clear? So here I was talking about electron transport chain. So now it is the time to discuss electron transport chain, another high yield topic. Electron transport chain takes place in the mitochondria. Okay, so we should know the role of mitochondria. So let me begin with the origins of this earth. Primitive earth was anaerobic. There was no oxygen in the atmosphere. Okay, certain unicellular organisms, they have the capability to produce oxygen, like cyanobacterium and all. Okay, then oxygen was coming into the environment. This oxygen was actually toxic to some anaerobic organisms. Certain organisms, they evolved to use oxygen. Okay, so those organisms, okay, for example, take that, there was some Rickettsia bacteria, okay, it was able to use oxygen, okay, and it invaded another organism, okay, and it became a parasite in that organism, okay, and in the long run, they merged together. So this is an endosymbiotic event, endosymbiotic event. In the similar way, chloroplast in plant, okay, chloroplast in the plant, it was also, it may be a cyanobacter, okay, cyanobacterium. So this was also another endosymbiotic event which helped plants to harvest solar energy, okay. This endosymbiotic events which helped plants, animals and other multicellular organisms to harvest the energy from oxygen. If you see all those pathways in the cytoplasm, they are predominantly anaerobic. Glycolysis is completely anaerobic pathway, okay, it does not require oxygen, it is the only pathway, okay, glucose is the only molecule which can produce energy without oxygen, okay. The end product of glycolysis is actually pyruvate, okay, it is pyruvate. But oxygen is used in mitochondria to produce more ATP. In anaerobic glycolysis, you are generating just 2 ATPs, but if there is a mitochondria, you can extract more electrons and produce more ATP. Clear? So this is the role of mitochondria. Now tell me, how many mitochondria are present in a cell? Multiple. Okay, in any image they will show you just one mitochondria for the representative purpose. So don't think there is only one mitochondria. There are numerous mitochondria in a single cell. That too actively exercising muscles and all, there are lot of mitochondria. Okay, red fibers. In red muscle fibers, there will be more mitochondria. Tell me how many DNA is present in one mitochondria? Multiple. Okay, mitochondria is polyploid. Okay, it contains lot of copies of mitochondrial genome. This is also important to understand. Mitochondria can synthesize its own proteins. Okay, 13 of the other 67 subunits of electron transport chain can be produced by the mitochondrial genome. Okay, see the mitochondria, it is a double layered structure, outer membrane, inner membrane, and there is a space between these membrane which is known as intermembranous space. Okay, and this is the matrix, and this inner membrane, it is folded upon itself to produce cristae. So thus the surface area is so high. Okay, there are a lot of proteins embedded in the inner membrane, like electron transport chain proteins. Okay, electron transport chain is happening in the inner membrane of the mitochondria. See here, the outer membrane is permeable to most molecules, but inner membrane is selectively permeable to molecules. This you should understand. And this is the same thing. See here, they have graphically represented that enzymes of the electron transport chains are coated. Enzymes and proteins of the electron transport chains are in the inner mitochondrial membrane. Okay. In the matrix, see what are the enzymes? TCA cycle, beta oxidation, pyruvate dehydrogenase, they are all in the matrix. So it is very easy, right? TCA cycle, it harvests electrons, it is the final common oxidative pathway, and it is directly going to give the electron to the inner mitochondrial membrane. Okay, but how come NADH produced in the cytoplasm will come through? It comes through certain shuttle pathways which we will discuss later. Okay, otherwise all the NADH, FADH2 produced inside the mitochondrial matrix, that is very easy, they can go and donate the electron here itself. Okay, but those coming from cytoplasm. For example, you know one NADH is produced in the glycolysis, right? In those cells which does not contain mitochondria, what is happening? This NADH will convert pyruvate to lactate. Okay, thus NAD plus will be regenerated and the glycolytic reaction proceeds. Okay, because there is no mitochondria, there is no oxygen to accept the electron from NADH, so this NADH cannot go anywhere. So in RBCs, NADH converts the pyruvate to lactate. In those cells with mitochondria, NADH is transported through shuttle mechanisms, glycerol 3-phosphate shuttle or malate aspartate shuttle, which we will discuss shortly. Now let us see the components of electron transport chain.